morning, everybody. Good to see you, although the lights, when they go on, I can't actually see you at all, so that might make this a little easier. But my name is Sharon Noble. I'm the Connections Pastor here, and I have the great privilege of bringing God's Word to you this morning. I don't know if any of you, and hopefully a lot of you, followed up with Pastor Jordan's homework this last week of going through your vows. Did anybody do that? Or were you like Matt and I, where our vows are on our wedding service tape, which is on a VHS tape, and we can no longer play it. We have to find a way to put it on something else. So Matt and I tried to recall our vows, and our vows were based on some of the traditional ones, but we had kind of made them our own, and we talked about for richer, for poorer, for better, for worse, for sickness and in health, and you know, realized Matt has gotten the short end of the stick when it comes to sickness or health. I have been put under general anesthesia 21 times. I know, that's a category you don't really want to be in. But I have gotten myself in that category, and that's just kind of what's happened to us. And I have married a good man. So if you are a young single woman out there, choose a good man. I chose a good one, really good man. That's the first choice. So this is our third week in our marriage series, and I get to talk about marriage this morning, and I'm going to talk about how marriage reflects God's love. But first of all, I want to show a photo of the newest, I think it's the newest photo. The newest, there we are. Okay, it's up there. So this is Kent and Alex. Congratulations. I don't know if they're in the house, but congratulations. 2 weeks they've been married. We are so proud of them. And then the next couple, they've been married almost 36 years. I can't see the screen. Is that Matt and I? Okay. So, yes, I know. That's when I was skinny and Matt had hair. So, you know, marriage brings a lot of change. You know, and at that point, we were two young people in love, and we just had no idea what God had in store for us. And so many good things. 5 children, wonderful things, and some really, really tough things. And I don't know if you're here today, I don't know what place in life you are. You might just be a kid, and you're like, marriage is the furthest thing from my mind. You might be a teenager. You might be a young person. You might be single or young married. It could be that you're here and you're going through a divorce right now. Or perhaps you're sitting here and your spouse is very ill, and you're looking at the end of life together. However you're here today, I am just going to ask the Lord to bless His Word, that it would speak to each of us, because God's Word is above and beyond anything we know, and His Holy Spirit always speaks through everything. So let's just pray real quick. Father in heaven, thank You for Your Word. Your Word never disappoints. You will speak to us at any stage of life, at any place of life, and I ask for that this morning. I ask that You would speak to us whether we're single or married or young or old, and that Your Word would nourish us, that You would encourage us and You would teach us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, so today we're going to talk about that we are designed to reflect God's love. So the first place that we need to go to talk about this is back to the Garden of Eden. In fact, in Genesis 2, the Garden of Eden is described. Lots of trees, lots of shrubbery, flowers, animals in the sky and on the ground, and livestock, and perfect peace. Can you imagine a place like that? Can you think of the most beautiful place you have ever been in? I've got a picture of a forest. These are one of my favorite. These are three of my favorite places to be: a forest, a river, and the beach. In fact, I find such peace in these places that I realize I can immediately connect with God. When I am standing in a forest, or sitting at the beach, or sitting beside a river, it is like my heart wants to worship. I am drawn into relationship with God immediately. In fact, there is an assessment called My Spiritual Pathways. And I don't know if anybody here has ever taken it, but when I took that assessment, it said that nature was my way of connecting with God. And I thought, boy, that is so true. Now, there was an interview done by the Christian Broadcasting Network of a woman back in September of 2019. So keep in mind this picture of the garden. In this story, she died and she went to heaven. And this is her story, and I think a lot of people would say it's credible, but I don't know. It's just her testimony. But listen to the parallels of the Garden of Eden. She said as soon as she died, she could see her body hovering above the bed. She could see her husband crying in the corner. She could see the nurses working on her. And then she smelled these fragrant flowers, more fragrant than she had ever smelled. And she saw all the trees and felt perfect peace. When we look in Genesis 2, that's what we see. Lots and lots of trees, flowers, rivers, and perfect peace. So I'm going to draw a parallel between the garden and between heaven. The garden represents the beginning of where it was perfect. Things were whole. There was complete peace. And what we see is Adam and Eve walking with God. And it actually looks like they're physically walking with God. We don't know for sure, but they're walking with God. And when you think about what heaven will be like, heaven will be a time of perfect peace, absolute beauty, and when we're fully reunited with God, we get to walk with God. So just kind of look at those as bookends with me. The Garden of Eden and heaven, they're mirrored images of one another. So let's go back to the garden. In the garden, Adam and Eve are created, and the scripture says they are unashamed of their nakedness. Now, it is a marriage series, so I'm going to use the word naked several times. So just get ready. The best of our relationship as a marriage, as people, was in the garden. Let's look at the first word, naked. The first use of the word naked comes from Genesis 2:25. The two of them were naked, and they were not ashamed. When our oldest daughter, Abby, was about three, she and her best friend, Philip, were in the backyard, and Philip's mom and I were sitting, and we were chatting, and they were playing in one of those kiddie pools, and, you know, they just start taking off their clothes. You know, I mean, they're three, they're little kids, they're taking off their clothes. Soon, they're like buck naked. Funny thing is that they were that way the entire morning. They ate lunch naked. You know, they continued to play naked. I mean, those clothes were, you know, they were restrictive, right? And this is really the definition of the first naked that we see in Genesis 2. Is it truly means unclothed, but it represents our spiritual condition, innocence. So we begin with our relationship with God and our relationship between man and woman or people with each other as completely without sin. It was perfect. It was wholesome. There was peace. There was no conflict. And then what happens in Genesis 3? If you know the story, you know that the serpent convinces Eve to eat the forbidden fruit. She eats it. Then she convinces her husband to eat it. And together they disobey God's command. At this point, the word naked changes. Here's the second use of naked. Genesis 3:7. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. The man and the wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called out to the man, "Where are you?" So the second naked is from a Hebrew word called Eram. This nakedness in 3:7 in Genesis has a different form and meaning. It carries the idea of being exposed, being vulnerable, and guilty to God's judgment. You see, when sin entered the garden, the relationship between man and God and man and woman and just man and mankind was fractured. It was broken. And all of a sudden, we were exposed. We were guilty. I've talked about this. We love dogs. Matt and I are a dog. I mean, our whole family's a dog family. And we had a dog named Cody. I've mentioned him before, actually. But our dog Cody was a chocolate lab. He's passed away a couple years ago now. But he was so funny. He would meet us at the door every time we would come in. And he would, you know, I mean, we could have gone all day without feeding Cody, and he would still be happy to see us, unless he had done something wrong. And this is why I think dogs are sinners. And I'm hoping that they're going to be redeemed and joined us in heaven. But we have two dogs currently, and they're both sinners as well. But one day, Cody had eaten a giant chocolate cake. It was a July 4th. He had eaten it. He should have died. He should have known better. You're not supposed to eat chocolate when you're a dog. But anyway, so he ate this whole cake. We walk in the door. We cannot find Cody. He is nowhere to be found. He is hiding from us. But of course, we knew his sin, just like God knew Adam and Eve had sinned. The RedeemerBible.org says the use of Eram, nakedness, in Genesis 3:7, in the aftermath of their disobedience to God, is the perceptive clue to the meaning of the story. Adam and Eve quickly realize far more than just being unclothed. They are both guilty under God's judgment. This is precisely why they tried to run away from the sound of God's voice and hide in the trees. In the same way, when a guilty man knows that he has a warrant out for his arrest and he hears the sound of a siren, and he too runs away and tries to hide. Guilt prompts us to look for hiding places. Guilt prompts us to look for hiding places. When was the last time that you were guilty of something? In your marriage, in a relationship, and you tried to hide it? When in our marriage and relationship, could be with our children, it could be a friendship, could be a coworker kind of deal, it could be a relationship in the church. When we try to hide from our guilt, this is destructive. We must tend to the garden of our relationships. Pastor Jordan talked about this a few weeks ago. Tend to the foxes in your marriage. We have to tend to the garden of our relationships. When sin entered the world, our relationships were fractured. They were broken. And so we will spend our lifetime working through making those relationships right. Remember the bookends? The garden and heaven. Relationships are perfect. And we've got this in-between time called life on earth. And we're going to work hard to repair those fractures in our sinful nature and in our relationships. Philippians 2:12 says, You have obeyed even more while I'm not with you. So continue to work out your own salvation. Do it with fear and trembling. God is working in you. He wants your plans and your acts to fulfill his good purpose. Now, Paul is telling us to work out our salvation, and sometimes this verse is misunderstood. So I want to make sure that we understand the context. Paul isn't referring to the salvation that we receive when we accept Jesus as our Savior. When we accept Jesus as our Savior, our sins are wiped clean. We are made clean before a holy God. And if we were to die that day, we would be in God's presence in heaven. It is a free gift. You cannot earn that. It is a free gift. You cannot earn it. That's really important. The gift of salvation is free. When Paul says work out your salvation, he's talking about that time here on earth and our relationships, that they're going to take hard work. It's not going to be easy. We are still living in a sinful world. Our relationships are still fractured because of the effects of sin. And we're going to have to take lots of time. It's going to require a great deal of sacrifice and effort to work them out. The Greek word work out here actually means to cultivate. So sin is like a seed that produces an evil behavior. And if we must work to cultivate good fruit, if you think about a farmer, what does a farmer need to do to cultivate a crop? He or she has to work every day diligently to cultivate that crop before they can finally reap a harvest. There's dozens and dozens of behavior. There's planting, and there's watering, and there's sheltering from bad weather, and there's fertilizing, and there's going back and chasing out the crows. And then finally, there's a harvest. Cultivating is a lot of work. Sometimes I think because we're so close to Hollywood and media and TV is such a part of our lives that we live in a fantasy land where we think being in love is always going to feel a certain way or look a certain way, or friendships are always going to take on a certain form, and they're always going to be easy, and as soon as they get hard, we get rid of it. But that's not what Scripture's telling us. Scripture's telling us that the first expression, marriage was the first expression of God's love, So it will be the first reflection of God's love. But in the garden, it was perfect. At heaven, it will be perfect. Here, in between this life on earth, between the bookends of the garden and heaven, we're going to have to work hard to till the soil, to cultivate healthy relationships. And as we do that, they will reflect God's love. Matt and I have a beautiful wood chair at home. In fact, it's a part of a set. If you've been in our house, we have this big farm table. We bought it, and the Lord gave us 5 children, so that's a little tip for some of you. Buy a big table, and the Lord will give you a lot of kids. Anyway, two of the chairs have actually fractured. One we were able to replace. The second one right now has this fracture right down the back. It's like a ladder back chair, and the fracture goes down the back, and we've glued it, and we can't replace it. They don't make them any longer. But it reminds us of marriage and just our relationships here on earth. That fracture is what happened when sin entered the garden, when sin entered our relationships. And even though we glue it, it's temporary. It's really temporary. So we're super careful with the chair. We try to make sure we're the only ones that sit in it. We push it aside when we're all eating, because if we were to be too rough on that chair, it would actually break. And that just makes me think that our relationships and marriage, they take a lot of tending. They take a lot of care. They've been fractured by sin. We still live in a world that we are experiencing the effects of sin. And so care is required. And I thought I would share with you just 6 lessons, quick little lessons that Matt and I have learned and are still learning while being married. And these are each found in Scripture. You know, Matt and I made some good choices when we were first married. And the first few of these were really good choices. Number 1, we are a marriage of 3 persons. Now, when I first read this to my husband, he was like, "What? Do you have something to tell me? We're a marriage of 3 persons." We're a marriage of Matt, myself, and the Holy Spirit. We truly are. And when we were in our wedding ceremony, and you could tell by our picture, that was back in the 80s, I actually modeled the gowns and everything after Princess Diana's wedding. And we know, unfortunately, what happened to that marriage. But we sung this song called "Bind Us Together." It's from Ecclesiastes 4:12. And it talks about a cord of 3 is stronger than a cord of 2. And I can't even believe we sung that, but we were just so in love, and we really wanted to establish our marriage on Christ. We wanted everyone to know. Do you know that your relationship, all of our relationships, should always be in the context of community? We're supposed to live out life together, even when it's tough. We live out life together. And Matt and I somehow realized that. And we wanted everyone to know that our relationship to Jesus was number 1. Absolutely number 1 to us. In fact, even now, almost 36 years into marriage, when we are struggling with each other, kind of that horizontal relationship, we always think, okay, we are probably not spending enough time in God's presence. Our vertical relationship has to be first before our horizontal relationships can be healthy. So first we are a marriage of 3 persons. Number 2, we are committed to commitment. Pastor Jordan mentioned this last week. We determined that we would be faithful until the end to one another. We knew that our marriage would reflect God's covenant to us, and He was faithful and is faithful to us, and we wanted to be faithful to one another. In Romans 8, it says, there is nothing that can separate us from God's love. Nothing. It doesn't matter how many mistakes you make, how many bad thoughts you have even. Those things cannot separate you from God's love. So we wanted nothing to separate us from our commitment to one another. We wanted our marriage to reflect the character of God. And we have not always succeeded. Ask our kids. I mean, wow, Matt and I both grew up wanting to be lawyers because we like to argue. That is really tough in a marriage. Arguing has not been our strong suit. We're both strong, we're leaders by nature, and we like to get our own way. We have worked diligently to remain committed and to work through those issues together. You know, we live in a disposable society as well. Does anybody remember darning socks? I can't even see your hands if you're raising them, but my mom, years and years and years ago, would darn my dad's socks. And that was just sewing the holes together in the socks. Well, nobody thinks about darning today. I mean, maybe Audrey Ross does. Where's Audrey? Audrey does everything. But otherwise, everybody but Audrey probably thinks about darning socks. But you know, today what do? We just go out and buy a new pair. They're pretty cheap. But our relationships were never intended to be disposable. They were never intended to be cheap. They were always intended to come with a price. In fact, Ruth Bell Graham once was asked this question: did she ever consider divorcing her husband, Billy Graham? She thought about it for a moment. She replied, "I haven't thought about divorce, but I have thought about murder." So if Ruth Bell Graham can think about murder, then I feel pretty good over here. Now, I think some of you are sitting right now, and as I talk about commitment to commitment, you are probably experiencing some pain because you have experienced a divorce. Perhaps you've experienced an unfaithful spouse. I don't know what you've been through or your relationships with your kids, relationship at work. I'm not here to judge. There's so much grace in Jesus. And he can heal whatever is broken. But you don't get a marriage of 72 years like John and Eileen Huntley's without deep-seated commitment. And I want to encourage you that if you're experiencing pain as we talk about marriage because you desire to be married, or because you have a broken marriage now, or because you've been divorced, or whatever's happened in your past, you can start right now being committed to commitment. And Jesus can heal anything. Number three, R-E-S-P-E-C-T spells respect. Every person has a different personality, a different temperament, gifts, and a God-given purpose. In fact, we actually see that purpose in the garden. If you go back to the garden before the fall, before sin fractured the relationship between man and woman and God and man, there was purpose given to man and purpose given to woman. They each had jobs. And then what happened is that when the serpent, let's just imagine the serpent represents the world, he begins to chatter to Eve, and she believes him rather than God. And then Adam, who should be standing up and protecting his family, what does he do? He blames Eve, and he hides. You see, the purpose that God originally gave us was also fractured. But we will spend again our lifetime realizing that purpose is still here. God has a calling on each of our lives. I have a calling on my life. Matt has a calling on his. And we spend a lot of time in our relationship trying to listen to one another and help each other fulfill that calling. I have a lot of respect for my husband. And that's part of the reason we're committed to one another. There's an example of Priscilla and Aquila. They're a couple and seen in Acts 18. In fact, Paul mentions them about three times. And they are this fantastic couple that are partners in missionary, and they're missionaries. They help the poor, they help the homeless, they serve Paul. And it's amazing, in the first century, when women were still considered property, that Aquila and Priscilla are partners in this relationship in the kingdom. And Paul recognizes them over and over. They were also, according to church history, eventually martyred together. So be careful. No, I don't know. Maybe Matt and I will be martyred. We did have five children. Sort of like being easy, he says. I know you'll give your life up for me, honey, so I'm not too concerned. I know. He's really a sweetheart. I married well. When we were, before we got married, actually, Matt said to the Lord, "I love Sharon so much. I want to make sure I don't love her more than you." I know, I married a good one. I'm telling you, I married a good man. That's your first choice, ladies. Marry a good man. Number four. Before we can get to number four, you really have to prep the way with one, two, and three. Jesus needs to be at the center. You need to be committed to commitment, and you need to be ready to show and demonstrate respect. You have to deeply respect your partner and your friend. This can go way beyond marriage into all relationships. But number four is one of the hardest. Be ready to forgive, forgive, and forgive. When we were first married, Matt would apologize for something he had done again. And I'd be like, oh, honey. And I just, you know, I'd just come out of some Bible classes, right? So I'd be like, the definition of repentance is changed behavior. Your behavior should be changing. You can't apologize over and over for the same thing. You should have changed behavior. Well, guess who wasn't being very Christ-like? It wasn't really Matt. It was me. Because the scriptures teach us to forgive and forgive and forgive. And if you're going to have healthy relationships, you have to be ready to forgive. We need to reflect God's love by forgiving others. What did God do for us? He sent us our son, his son, while we were yet sinners. Wow. Talk about a role model. That's hard to live up to. And again, between the bookends of Garden and Heaven, we're going to work and work on forgiving, and we're going to make a lot of mistakes. I sure have. But God is faithful, and we will continue to reflect God's love as we forgive. Don't make a mountain out of a molehill. That's an old idiom, but it was said by John Huntley. Again, John's like my favorite person today. And John then said, soon after he said that, he said this to Pastor Jordan and I a few weeks ago. He said, don't make a mountain out of a molehill. Mountains are much harder to get over. And I thought, wow, that's really good. Because Matt hates it when I leave soaking dishes in the sink. So if I'm feeling really ornery, I just leave him in the sink. I know. I'm a sinner. I'm just like our dogs. Total sinner. But if I love my husband, then what am I going to do? We've agreed it's okay to put the dishes on the counter and let them soak there. So if I really want to demonstrate love and allow God's love to be reflected through my actions, I put the dishes on the sink to soak. Because otherwise, I'm a contributor to making a mountain out of a molehill. It's those little things that trip us up. Now, sometimes mountains are thrust upon us. You may have experienced abuse, infidelity, the death of a child, something really giant in your marriage. And I just want to remind you that we're here to support you. Pastor Jordan mentioned our benevolence fund, so you may have lost a job. There may be something like that. And we, as a church body, we are your community. We want to surround you and help you live out life. Remember that marriage was always in the context of community in Scripture. There's an interdependence that we need to experience with each other. Number five, good communication will make or break. There was a comedian that said, he was pretending to be God, and he said, let me create Adam and Eve, and let me create Adam, and then I'll give him Eve, and I'm just going to sit back and watch what happens. You know, we are two very different types of creatures, aren't we? And even though we have a natural draw towards one another, we find it challenging to live together. The other day, Matt and I already told him I was going to tell this story. I just told him, I said, you know I'm preaching in 2 weeks, and you're just simply giving me material. So we're walking out of Target, and about 30 seconds into literally, I am like telling him something really important, and I'm, you know, just kind of baring my soul a bit, and about 30 seconds in, he says, I just need to be honest. I haven't been listening to anything you've been saying. I know. I said, you know, I'm preaching in 2 weeks. Come on. You're just like handing me material. So the reality is it is hard when you're walking. You've got a mask on. You're behind each other. So I get it. My husband really does try to listen to me. But he does, you know, after an hour and a half, he is spent. Thank you, babe. So, but in communication, Matt and I determined early on that we were not going to make any decisions without talking with each other, that we believe we are a partnership, and we believe the Holy Spirit speaks to both of us. And if it was a big decision about our kids or our livelihood or something of that kind of nature, not little decisions about, you know, what we're going to eat for dinner necessarily, but big decisions, that we would always communicate. And if we could not agree, we would wait. We would wait for the Spirit to speak to us. We would wait until we had consensus between us. And this means we have to spend time together. Before we had kids, this was pretty easy. Once we had kids, five little ones, some of them coming, our third and fourth child are 20 months apart. So, I mean, we were busy people. We were still serving in the church and full-time jobs and all kinds of stuff. So we were busy, but we got creative. We had a little condo and we had a little sidewalk in front. We would just walk while the kids were still asleep and we would pray. We would talk about our week. We were creative about finding ways to communicate. You have to be intentional. We have good friends, Matt and Cheryl Nelson, and they moved to Washington when their oldest was 7. He was real little. He's 31 now. And so we determined to get together every summer to camp. We were intentional about our relationship. You have to be intentional and schedule what matters. According to Dawn and Alex Flecky, communication is the number one issue in marriages. It's the number one reason there's a breakdown in a marriage. And good news is that on May 7th, at our marriage event, Dawn and Alex are coming to speak to us. Now, what's funny about this is they're coming and they're going to speak about communication. And the DeLafous, Brittany and Nick, invited us to a couple talk, a six-week series. That's a video. It's a Dawn and Alex on video. And Matt and I are actually hosting one this summer. And they invited us as the wisdom couple. And I thought, they don't know about that lawyer side. They don't know how much we argue. They wouldn't invite us. And so we went for these 6 weeks, and we learned several things that were really key in being able to communicate, because that's the hardest area for us. We have to continually work on communication. So May 7th, be sure you sign up for that night. It's free. You just go to mesa.church/events. Find May 7th, a marriage event, X's and O's date night, and sign up. The Fleckys are fantastic. And it really doesn't matter what stage of marriage you're in or whether or not you're single, although we are asking at that event that you intend you be with someone you intend to marry. So think about who you want to invite, girls. Okay, so, and number six, the last one, is laughter is the glue. Laughter is the glue. Proverbs 17:22, a cheerful heart is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. UC Berkeley psychology professor Dr. Keltner conducted research on a number of couples who'd been married for more than 13 years, and guess what he found was the one ingredient they all had in common? Laughter. They all had laughter in common. Laughter, this is laughter at big issues, funny things that you can both laugh about, not demeaning one another's character in front of other people. It's the laughter where, for example, when I had cancer and was pregnant with our youngest son and I lost all my hair. Matt actually shaved my head one night. That was a fun experience as a married couple. We used to laugh about how hair was overrated. It cost a lot of money, and now I didn't have anything. I didn't have to worry about it. I didn't have to fix it in the morning. It was so much easier with five kids and so on. We found something in that difficult experience to laugh about, and that's the type of laughter that I'm talking about. So just six simple lessons from Scripture that illustrate, at least for Matt and I, longevity and trying to reflect God's love, which was established and first expressed in the garden. I'd like to close with one final love story. This is my parents' love story. My mom, I know. I heard someone, oh, I know, it's so sweet. Mom and Dad met at a church in Alhambra, California, while my dad was on leave from the Navy. He had just completed a 2-year tour and was at a church looking for women. I think my mom must have noticed him first, though. He came walking into the lobby of the church building, decked out in his sailor uniform, which immediately caught my mom's eye. They soon started dating, and their love story began. Fortunately for my dad, my grandfather believed in him, since my grandmother had no love for sailors, especially dating her daughter. 3 years later, they were married and would experience the ups and downs of life. My dad soon lost his mom in a car accident to a drunk driver. the birth of their five children, finishing multiple educational degrees, moving this young family across country several times, a miscarriage, a child with a learning disability, often short money, job changes, major back surgery, a child who broke his neck and was forever confined to a wheelchair, a daughter with cancer, and two kids moving back across country, away from the family, and finally, my dad's cancer. Their lives were full of many, many opportunities for God's love to be reflected in their relationship to their children and to the others around them. But in one final moment of compassion, I watched my mom reflect God's love to my dad in a visual that I will never forget. As my dad lay in hospice in their family room, my mother tirelessly served him. She would sleep beside him in a chair and she'd wake up all night long to get him whatever he needed. She would read scripture to him and she would just simply be present. One day I asked my mom, I said, "Mom, do you need a break? I can stay with dad and you can go sleep in your bed or run to the store or get your nails done. Just spend some time relaxing." She said, "I don't want to be anywhere else but here. How can I be? He is the love of my life. My place is beside him." When we think about God's expression of love first being demonstrated in marriage and then being reflected in our lives, I think of my parents. I think about John and Eileen Huntley. I think about Keith and Mert Ewing. I think about the people within this body and those within my family that are reflecting God's love. Just like my mom, she reflected God's compassion, his kindness, and his faithfulness. Can we be reflections of God's love in our relationships today, especially our marriages, but in all of our relationships, that we might be reflections, expressions originally by God and reflections to point people to Jesus? Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we love you today. We desire to be reflections of your love. Thank you for the first expression of love that was in the garden between Adam and Eve, man and woman. And even though sin has fractured that relationship and all the relationships here on earth, we ask that you would restore those first through Jesus and then through just simply our hard work. Would you give us the courage and the strength to do everything that we need to do to make our relationships right and whole before you? We love you in your perfect love, and we look forward to being reunited in perfect peace with you one day in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.